I want to just take a moment and just welcome all of you to Cooper City Church of God this morning. Doesn't this look good in this house today? I wish that those who were watching via online today, I wish they could just see what's going on in this house here this morning. We welcome our online audience, and we welcome our satellite campus in Birmingham, City of Lights. Would you help me welcome them today? And as I said, those of you watching, I just wish you could see what I see in here this morning, that there's not an empty seat hardly in the house. People are standing around the back because we're running out of seats. We thought we had a good idea to just do one service, but we've grown to the point now that it's hard to fit everybody in to one service. But it's so good to see you today. If Jamie and I have not had the opportunity to meet you, we would sure welcome that opportunity before you leave today. I know that it can get a little congested trying to get out of here, and everybody's trying to get out quickly. But we'll be back at Connection Central, and we would love to have the opportunity to meet you before you leave today. Amen. Well, as good as the music has been, I don't think any service is complete without the Word of God. And over the last few weeks, we have been in a series called Christmas at the Movies. And it has been an incredible series for us. We started this series talking about Home Alone, and then It's a Wonderful Life. And then last week, we talked about the movie Elf. Today, the movie that we're going to talk about is The Grinch That Stole Christmas. Now, I know what some of you are probably thinking. You're probably kind of thinking the same thing that you thought about Elf. You're probably thinking, what is there redemptive? What kind of redemptive principles are there in the movie How the Grinch Stole Christmas? Well, let me tell you what I believe. I believe that this is a movie all about redemption. I really do. I believe that it's a movie all about redemption. Have you ever thought about why the Grinch was the Grinch? How did he become the Grinch? Now, when we watch the movie, you know, the very first thing we see is all of the hustle and bustle of the people down in Whoville trying to get their last-minute Christmas shopping done. And we can tell immediately that everybody has forgotten what the real true meaning of Christmas is, except for this one little girl named Cindy Lou Who. And Cindy Lou Who is going to be a very vital piece to this movie, a very vital part in the redemption of the Grinch. But it doesn't take long to find out that they've got their priorities out of order down in Whoville, and all they can think about is getting all of their Christmas shopping done. Matter of fact, Cindy Lou's dad even celebrates the fact that he has maxed out his credit card and celebrates over the fact that he says it's going to take years to pay this thing off. And a lot of people would think, well, that's the reason why the Grinch was the Grinch, is because people had lost the true meaning of Christmas. But I believe that if you really watch the movie closely, you're going to find out that what made the Grinch in this movie, and we know it is just a movie. We know it is just a story, and we know that there is really no such thing as the Grinch as you see him on the screen here today, but how many of you do know a lot of Grinchy people? Right? And I think what led to the Grinch becoming the Grinch, it's what leads to a lot of people becoming Grinchy in their own life today. And it's really a very serious thing. But I think what led to the Grinch being the Grinch was rejection. It was rejection. I mean, you think about it, and it's really a strange story, you know, that on Christmas Eve, all these babies just kind of float into Whoville. And Grinch is one of those. And from the time that Grinch arrives at Whoville as a baby, he's rejected. He's rejected because of how he looks. He's rejected because of how he acts. And then when he grows up a little bit and he's in elementary school, he kind of has feelings for another girl down in Whoville named Martha Mayhew, and he makes her a custom-made gift from him. Shows up at school the next day, and all the kids exchange their gifts. And once everybody's exchanged their gifts, the teacher looks at them and says, okay, has everybody given the gifts that you brought to give? When all of a sudden, she hears a voice from behind the curtain saying, I haven't. And Grinch walks out from behind the curtain with a bag over his head. And the reason why he has a bag over his head is because some of his peers have kidded him, because at such a young age, he's already starting to grow hair on his face. And so in his attempt to try to shave the hair off of his face, as many of us guys do sometimes, we don't do a very good job. And he has little pieces of tissue all over his face where he's cut himself. And he doesn't want anybody to see it, and so he has this bag over his head. And his teacher requires him to remove the bag off of his head. And once the bag is off of his head, now they can see all the damage that's been done to his face. And everybody in the class starts laughing at him. And then they start making fun of the gift that he had made for Martha. And in that moment, he felt rejection. And not only that, but it was on Christmas Eve, and because it was connected to Christmas Eve, it caused the Grinch to forever hate Christmas because of the rejection that he experienced on that particular day, Christmas Eve, in the movie Grinch. Now, I think all of us here this morning knows what it's like to feel rejected. It doesn't matter how young you are. It doesn't matter how old you are. All of us know what it feels like to be rejected. We've all felt the sting of rejection. Am I right? So what I want to talk to you about this morning for just a few minutes, I want to talk to you on this subject, redeemed from rejection. Redeemed from rejection. Now, next week is New Year's Eve, and we're going to be having two services next week. We're going to have a 10:30 a.m. service, and then we're also going to have a 10:30 p.m. service. And in that 10:30 p.m. service, I'm going to share with you the theme or the word that I believe the Lord has given us as we go into 2024. And that word is simply this: keep moving forward. Keep moving forward. And listen, if you and I are going to be able to keep moving forward toward the purpose and plan and destiny that God has for us, we've got to be redeemed from our rejection. Because rejection is not something that we want to take with us, or should I say, those things that have happened to us as a result of rejection. These are not things that we want to take with us into 2024. If we want 2024 to be the kind of year that God wants it to be for all of us. Now, let me just say this. Jesus can empathize with our rejection. The Bible tells us here in Isaiah chapter 53, verse 3, that he was despised, or is despised, and rejected by men. Now, other translations says it like this: he was despised. But I don't believe that Jesus was despised just in the past. I think that he continues to be despised, even in our culture today, and that many continue to reject him on a daily basis. So Jesus can empathize with rejection. He is despised. He's rejected by men. John chapter 1, verse 11, listen to what it says. It says that he came to his own, and his own did not receive him. Now imagine that. Jesus comes, and that's the whole story of Christmas. Jesus comes to his own people, the Jewish nation. Jesus comes to his own people, and his own people, who had inside information that other people did not have about his birth, about his entrance into this world, about the life and the ministry that he would have here on this earth. Those that had inside information, the Bible said that Jesus came to his own, and his own did not receive him. How many of you know what it's like to be rejected by your own? By your own friends, by your own peers, by your own family members. You know, there's a number of ways we can experience rejection. Maybe some of you are still carrying that rejection of asking that girl or that guy to the prom, and they rejected you. They said no. Or maybe there's somebody here this morning that's still carrying that rejection of proposing and asking someone to marry you, only to have them reject you. Or maybe some of you thought that this year was going to be the year that you were going to get that promotion at work, but then somebody else got your promotion and you have been left feeling rejected. So the question this morning is not, have you ever been rejected? We've all been rejected. We all know what it's like to feel the sting of rejection. So that's not the question. The question this morning is, how are we going to respond to rejection in our lives? And I think there's a number of ways that we can respond if we're not careful, even some unhealthy ways that we can respond to rejection if we're not careful. And we even see that these are some of the ways that the Grinch himself responded to rejection. First of all, some people's response to rejection is to retreat. You remember the movie, The Grinch? What did he do after he was rejected? He retreated to Mount Crumpet, and he hid himself in a cave. And he convinced himself, I don't need those people. All I need is myself. I'm better off if I just live here alone all by myself. And you and I, we have a tendency to do the same thing if we're not careful. We put ourselves out there. We offer our advice. We share our ideas only to be rejected. And so we decide, well, we're not going to put ourselves out there like that anymore. We're not going to share our ideas anymore, because the last time I shared my ideas, everybody looked at me like I was stupid. So we retreat and we hide in a cave, thinking that we no longer need people in our lives. And that's exactly what the Grinch did. But not only can we respond with retreat, another way that people respond to rejection is to resent. Because if we're not careful, we can respond to rejection by getting angry and by getting bitter and by being filled with hatred in our hearts. And again, that's exactly what the Grinch did. You'll find that there is a place in the movie where the Grinch comes out and he stands on the ledge overlooking Whoville. And he takes out a directory. I don't know, it may be a phone directory, but it has everybody's name that lives down in Whoville, and he just goes name by name, and he points at a name, and he says, I hate them. And then he looks at another name, I hate them. And then he looks at another name, I loathe them. And how many of you know that you and I can respond the same way to rejection if we're not careful? We can allow our hearts to become filled with bitterness and hatred toward those who rejected us. Here's another way that we can respond to rejection if we're not careful, and that is we can retaliate. Now, retaliate is not the same thing as revenge. I'll talk about revenge here in just a moment. But retaliate is when somebody has been rejected, and here's how they retaliate. They retaliate by saying, I'll show them that they were wrong about me. I'll show them that I have more potential than what they recognize in me. I'll show them that I'm more talented than they think I am. I'm more gifted than they think I am. That I'm smarter than I think I am. And they spend the rest of their lives trying to prove themselves to someone who has rejected them. How many of you know what I'm talking about this morning? Because there's some in this room here today that you have spent literally the last 20 years of your life trying to prove people wrong about you. It's your way of retaliating. And then when retaliation is connected with anger, it becomes revenge. And man, that's what happened with the Grinch. He didn't just want to get even. He wanted them to hurt the way that he had hurt. He wanted them to feel the same kind of pain that he felt as a result of his rejection. And he felt like that the best way that he could inflict pain on them was to steal Christmas from them. And so what does he do on Christmas Eve? He goes down and he steals everybody's gifts, thinking that he has destroyed Christmas for all of those people down in Whoville. But there is always little Cindy Lou Who. And when everybody else was moaning and groaning and griping and complaining about all of their stuff being gone, little Cindy Lou Who helped everybody get their perspective back on what Christmas really is. And that Christmas is not about getting presents, but Christmas is about showing love and acceptance to those who have been rejected. And that's what Cindy Lou Who does with the Grinch. Because you see, you and I, we can either retreat, we can resent, we can retaliate, we can seek revenge, or we can let God redeem our rejection. Amen? And that's what happens with the Grinch. It was the love and it was the acceptance of Cindy Lou Who that totally touched him, redeemed him, and changed his heart so that he could love and accept others again. Look at this video clip.
Merry Christmas. It's Christmas Eve and it's week 4 and the final installment of our Christmas at the Movie series. In case you haven't joined us in previous weeks, at this part of the message, we're sharing a poignant clip from the movie, The Grinch Who Stole Christmas, or some simply call it The Grinch. Now, again, rest assured, there's nothing wrong with your reception or this stream, but due to the strict copyright guidelines, we are not permitted to broadcast the movie clip that is currently being played right here in our sanctuary. Today, we are sharing the climactic moment in the movie. The moment after the Grinch has wreaked havoc on Whoville and caused all sorts of mayhem in the throes of stealing all the presents, ruining the decorations, and otherwise living up to the expectations of those who loathed him most in Whoville because he was different. Now, all the years of pent-up bitterness, frustration, and isolation finally resulted in the Grinch carrying out one of the most heinous acts one could commit on Christmas, stealing toys from little girls and boys, taking away everything that to him represented Christmas and the joy of the celebration. The Grinch wanted instead to see them in sorrow and tears and to hear the wailing and the gnashing of teeth and the bellowing of the bitterly bummed out. After having caused a Christmas conundrum in Whoville, now ascended back to the top by his lair on the mountain overlooking Whoville, having stolen Christmas, the Grinch expected to hear those voices. He expected to hear that wailing, but instead, he hears another sound altogether different. Rising up over the snow, it started low, and it started to grow. The sound didn't seem sad at all. It seemed merry, very merry. All the Who's in Whoville were singing without any presence at all. Then the Grinch came to this realization. He hadn't stopped Christmas after all. It came just the same. He stood there puzzled. How could it be so? It came without ribbons. It came without tags. It came without packages, boxes, or bags. He puzzled and he puzzled till his puzzler was sore. Then he thought of something he hadn't thought of before. Maybe Christmas, he thought, doesn't come from a store. Maybe Christmas, perhaps, means a little bit more. This was the Grinch's epiphany. It affected him so much that it knocked him off his feet, and he convulsed from the reaction, and he exclaimed that he was feeling a new experience to him. It was said by those in Whoville that his heart grew 3 times that day. Now, that experience of feeling would continue in these moments on the mountain. The darkened sky would give way to sunshine, and that would warm the Grinch's heart, making him feel all toasty inside. With tears running down his face, also a new experience, the Grinch notes that he is leaking. Then, looking over at his sidekick, his loyal dog Max, the one that had stuck by him even though he had been mistreated, the Grinch looks at him and he declares, "I love you." Love had indeed penetrated that crusty, embittered heart of the Grinch. What a beautiful scene. I almost cry every time. Now, we're going to rejoin our live broadcast in just a brief moment as Pastor Victor wraps up this message on the Grinch and this series of Christmas at the Movies. Thanks for being a part of the worship experience today. Next Sunday is New Year's Eve, and we'll only be streaming and having service in-house at 10:30 a.m. and 10:30 p.m. in the evening. So we hope to see you here in-house. But if you can't make it, we're glad you're able to join us here. And on behalf of all of us here at Cooper City Church of God, we want to wish you and yours a Merry Christmas. Stay tuned as we'll rejoin the service momentarily.
You know, there's some folks here this morning that need to experience that kind of transformation and that kind of redemption in your heart today. I want you to listen to what Peter, and Peter is someone that could really talk to us as well about rejection. But listen to what Peter said in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 4, about the redemption of rejection. He says, coming to him, talking about us, coming to Jesus, as to a living stone, and look at what it says about Jesus, that he was rejected indeed by men, but chosen by God and precious. And then verse 5 says this, you also as living stones, you are being built up a spiritual house. Look at your neighbor and say, God's building something great out of me. That you also as living stones are being built up a spiritual house, a holy priesthood, to offer up spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. And then verse 6 says this, therefore it is also contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone. Let me tell you what the chief cornerstone, now here he's talking about Jesus. But a chief cornerstone would have looked something like this, maybe a little bit bigger. And the chief cornerstone was so important. It had to be completely perfect, and it had to be completely square. Why? Because it was the first stone to be laid, and every other stone in the building would be aligned with this stone. And if this stone was not perfect and perfectly square, then the whole building would not be as square as it needed to be. And notice what it says about the cornerstone, that Jesus is the chief cornerstone, elect and precious. And then it says that he who believes on him, how many of you have put your faith in Jesus today, that you believe on him? It says that he who believes on him will by no means be put to shame. And this is what that means. That means that when you come to Jesus, no matter who you are, no matter what you've done, no matter where you've been, that he will not reject you. He will not reject you, but he will accept you. That's how much he loves you. And then verse 7, notice what it says. Therefore, to you who believe, he is precious. But to those who are disobedient, the stone, now understand, the stone was perfect. The stone was perfectly square. How many of you know that Jesus was the perfect Son of God? But even though he was perfect, even though he was tempted in every way like you and I, he never sinned. He lived a perfect, sinless life. But even though he was perfect, notice, it was the stone which the builders rejected. How many of you know that Jesus was perfect and they still rejected him? Maybe now you'll understand why people reject you in your imperfection. Amen? Because you can be perfect and still some people are going to reject you. But notice it says that the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone. Do you know what that passage of scripture is saying? It's saying that God specializes in taking what has been rejected by men, and God can take it and build something beautiful and something awesome and something great out of those who have been rejected. Somebody ought to thank God for that today. Amen. You see, I believe that God can bring blessing out of your rejection. How does he do that? Give me just a few more minutes. First of all, he does this. I believe that God can use rejection to reveal some things in our lives. To reveal some things. How many of you in this room here today would say, Pastor, I know that God has destined me to do great things. That God has put in my heart some really big dreams. And I have some high hopes. And I know that God has a great purpose for my life. I'm sure there's many of you in here like that today. But do you know what rejection does? And you've got to understand that if you're going to do anything great with your life, you're going to have to be willing to experience the pain of rejection. Because there is going to be some rejection along the way. And what you've got to decide is, do I want to live with the pain of rejection? Or do I want to live with the pain of regret? Because what will happen if you're not careful is you will allow your pain of regret or your fear or your pain of being pushed away, your pain of being rejected, if you're not careful, you will allow that to stop you from pursuing your dreams. You will allow that to keep you from pursuing the purpose and the plan that God has for your life. But I believe that the Holy Spirit brought you here this morning to hear this. And that is that if you really believe that this is God's plan for your life, if you really believe that God has given you some hopes and dreams, if you really believe that God has a great purpose for your life, that nothing will stop you, including the rejection of other people. You don't want to get to the end of your life and have all kind of regrets as to why you didn't try. Because so many people are going to come to the end of their life, and because of a fear of rejection, they're going to recognize, I didn't dare the way I should have dared. I didn't take a risk the way that I should have taken a risk because I was afraid of being rejected. You've got to decide today, do you want to live with the pain of rejection or do you want to live with the pain of regret? And let me tell you what Jesus chose. Jesus chose the pain of rejection. Jesus knew that his ultimate purpose was to come to this earth to die on a cross so that your sins and my sins could be forgiven. And Jesus knew that on the way to the cross that there would be many that would reject him. But he was willing to endure the rejection so that he wouldn't have any regrets. And you've got to decide that today. Do you want to live with the pain of rejection? Or do you want to live with the pain of regret? Here's another thing that rejection does. It doesn't just reveal what's really important to you. Because listen, if it's really important to you, then you're willing to push through the rejection. You're willing to push through the pain of rejection. And if you're not willing to push through the pain of rejection, then evidently it's not as important to you as you thought it was. But not only that, let me tell you something else that rejection does. Rejection reveals who the people are that are really with you. In John chapter 6, Jesus has been preaching a heavy word to his disciples. He even said something like this. He said, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, then you can have no part of me. In other words, Jesus was letting these followers know that if they rejected me, they're going to reject you as well. And because of that hard teaching, look at what happened in verse 66 of John chapter 6. It said, from that time, many of his disciples went back and walked no more with him. They rejected him. And Jesus then looked at his disciples, and look at what he said in verse 67. He said to the 12, he said, do you also want to go away? But Simon Peter answered him and said, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. And he said, also, we have come to believe and know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. You see, it reveals who's with you and who's not with you. Listen, I used to get really upset. I'm just going to be honest with you. I used to get really upset. I used to get really discouraged. I used to get really disoriented if certain people left the church, because I took it personal that they were not just leaving the church, but that they were leaving me. They were rejecting me. And man, I mean, I struggled with that for many years in ministry. Nothing that I could do to stop it, but I struggled with it for many years. But do you know what I've come to find out? I've come to find out that when somebody leaves your life, that God already has an upgrade in mind. Amen. That God's already got somebody else in mind that he's going to bring into your life, that's going to be an upgrade in your life, that he's going to use to help you to get from where you are to where you need to be in God. Hallelujah. So rejection reveals. It reveals what's really important to you. It reveals who's really with you and who's not with you. Here's something else that rejection does. Rejection refines. If you allow it, God can use rejection to refine you. How many of you have ever had to go in for one of those dreaded office employee evaluations? And your boss sits you down and says, okay, if you're going to go to the next level of leadership, there's some things that you're going to need to correct in your life. Now, you've got a choice in that moment. You can look at your boss and get up and say, who do you think you're talking to? I've been with this company for 20 years, and you need to learn to accept me for who I am. No, what we need to understand is that correction is not rejection. And even God will have a moment with us where he wants to correct some things in us, and it's not opposition, it's opportunity that is before us. How many of you know that Job, if anybody had a real reason to feel rejected, it would have been Job of the Old Testament? I mean, first of all, he could have felt like God had rejected him, because all God did was allow Satan to come in and take everything that Job had. And then on top of that, all of his friends showed up and they were no help. They were like, well, Job, you need to fess up, man, because things like this don't happen to people unless they've sinned. And evidently you've sinned because of all this bad stuff that's happening in your life. So he could have felt rejection from God and from his friends, and he could have also felt rejected by his wife. Because in the worst, darkest moment of his life, she shows up and says, Job, why don't you just curse God and die? But do you know what Job said in the midst of all of this in Job chapter 23, verse 10? Listen to what he says. He says, but the Lord knows the way that I take. There's another translation that says it like this. God knows where I'm going. And because God knows where I'm going, God knows what he needs to refine in me. What he needs to correct in me so that I can get to where it is that God is taking me. And he said that he knows the way that I take. And when he has tested me, I shall come forth as gold. We need to look at rejection as God taking an opportunity here to refine us. The problem is sometimes the heat gets to be so much that we get out of the fire long before God's refining process is done in our lives. I've come to tell somebody this morning, do not grow weary in doing good, for in due season, hallelujah, God is going to bring a harvest. God is going to refine you. God is trying to make gold out of you. Amen. And then there's a third thing. Not only does rejection reveal and rejection refine. And this is what I love most about rejection, is that rejection, God can use it to redirect. To redirect our lives. Again, you need to understand that God sees the beginning from the end. God sees things that you and I are not able to see. God doesn't just see where you are. God sees where you're going. And because of that, sometimes when you see an opportunity and think that this is a door that God is going to open for me, that I can step through to my destiny, and then when you get to that door is closed. But instead of looking at that as rejection, you need to take it as God redirecting you, because God has a better path and a better plan for your life. Those of you that know me know I'm from Alabama. It's where I was born and raised. And you're raised on two kinds of music in Alabama. You're raised on gospel music and country music. And I think Garth Brooks got it right when he said, sometimes I thank God for unanswered prayers. Because sometimes we even look at unanswered prayer as rejection from God, that we've asked God for something and that God rejected our request. Let me tell you something. You wouldn't be who you are today, and you wouldn't be where you are today, if God had not redirected your life. None of us would be who we are today, and none of us would be where we are today if we had gotten everything that we asked God for. Thank God for unanswered prayers. We don't look at it as rejection, but we trust God that He has a better plan, that He has a better purpose for our lives. So remember that the next time that you're told no on that promotion. Remember that next time you propose and that person tells you no. It's because God's redirecting you. You remember what Proverbs chapter 3 verses 5 and 6 says. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and lean not to your own understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him, and He shall direct your paths. Amen. There may be some closed doors along the way, but like I said, it's just God taking you around, because He's got something greater and something better in store for you. Come on, somebody. That's about the best Christmas gift I can give you. I want you to look at this stone that I'm holding in my hand this morning. This stone that represents rejection in your life. People who didn't understand you. People who didn't appreciate you. People who didn't recognize the potential that God has placed inside of you. People who brushed off your ideas, your desires. I want you to look at this stone as that rejection, and I want to tell you two things. First of all, that stone will either be something that breaks you, or it will be something that you can build on. And Jesus, God, took the stone that the builders rejected. And do you know what He built? He built the church. And when I say the church, I'm not talking about a building. I'm talking about people. So I want you to look around this room here this morning. Because not only did God take the stone, the chief cornerstone that was rejected by the builders to build something, but I want you to look throughout this whole building this morning how God has taken living stones that have been rejected by others. But God has used your life to build something great. And to build something incredible. And to build something that will last long after you have left this world. Everybody should have received when you come in this morning, you should have received your communion elements. If you didn't, you can raise your hand and we have ushers that will bring those to you. I see a few hands going up. So what are you going to do today? Are you going to choose the pain of rejection? Or are you going to choose the pain of regret? You know, the reason that some even are slow about making a decision to be a follower of Christ is because of your fear of rejection. Christ is not going to reject you, but you, there's some that feel that if I accept Jesus Christ as my personal Savior, then my friends aren't going to want anything to do with me anymore. My family's not going to want anything to do with me anymore. But you've got to decide. Do you want to live with the pain of rejection or regret? Because you don't want to come to the end of your life having not put your faith and trust in the one who gives the gift of eternal life. With every head bowed and every eye closed in this room for just a moment, if you're here today and you would say, Pastor, time and time again, I've been in a service like this, and I've had an opportunity to receive Christ as my Savior, and I've rejected Him. But today, I'm not going to reject Him any longer. Today, I'm ready to receive. I'm ready to accept Him as my Lord, as my Savior, because I know that He's one who can redeem my pain of rejection. That He can take the curse of my rejection and He can make a blessing out of it. That He can redeem me and He can redeem my rejection today. And if that's you, as you sit there in that seat this morning, the privacy of your space, all you've got to do is say, Jesus, I accept You today as my Lord and my Savior. I ask You to forgive me of my sins. I need You in my life. I need You in my family. I need You in my marriage. I need You to invade every area of my life today. And so I don't just receive You as my Savior, but I want You to be the Lord of my life. I want You to take complete control of my life today. Today, Lord Jesus, I commit my life to You. And I say, not my will, but Your will be done in my life. Lord, help me to understand Your word so that I can be an obedient follower of everything Your word commands me to do. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Can we thank God for those that may have just prayed that prayer today? Hallelujah. We thank You, Jesus. And listen, if you did, if you just accepted Jesus Christ as your personal Savior this morning, if you decided, I'm not going to reject Him anymore, but I'm inviting Him into my life, we've got some information that we want to put in your hand before you leave today. A Bible and some other materials that will help you as you begin your journey with Jesus this morning. Amen. These elements that we hold in our hands today, the bread and the cup, remind us of the price that Jesus paid to redeem us from rejection. First of all, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it. And he looked at his disciples and he said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you, so that you could be healed and you could be whole." Let's take the bread together this morning in remembrance of him. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. You were wounded for our transgressions. You were bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement for our peace was on you, and with your stripes were healed. Thank you, Jesus, that you were willing to endure the pain of rejection. And you could endure the pain of rejection because you knew that you were accepted and that you were loved by your Father. And Lord, I pray that every person in this room here today will understand the same. That as they too decide to endure the pain of rejection in their life, that they will understand that even though they may be rejected by men, that they're loved and they're accepted by you, God. On that same night, Jesus took a cup full of wine and he blessed it. He said that this cup represents my blood. We talked about him being the perfect Son and the perfect Lamb of God. Not just any blood could wash away our sins, church. It had to be the blood of the precious, spotless, perfect Lamb of God. And on the cross, he shed his blood so that your sins and my sins, the Bible said it like this, though they be as crimson, they shall be white. We shall be white as snow. Come on, let's take a cup together this morning in remembrance of Jesus. Amen. I'm going to ask if you would to stand all over the house. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father God, that you love us, that you accept us, that you can even use rejection to reveal, to refine us, to redirect us. Lord, this Christmas Eve, we pray not our will, but your will be done in our lives. In the name of Jesus, we pray. And everybody has said amen. And amen. Pastor Darren and the altar ministry team is going to be here. We're not closing just yet. The team is going to lead us in a song as we leave, and then our host is going to come with some important announcements. But church, Jamie and I love you so much. Again, just look around. Isn't this a beautiful sight in this room here today? Amen. And again, if you accepted the Lord Jesus Christ today, come back there and tell us. Let us know of this decision that you've made to follow Jesus. Amen. The altar ministry team is coming. We're going to worship. If you need prayer for anything today, they are here to pray over you and to pray for you. God bless you. Merry Christmas.